The Historical Society on BCTV is supported by the Highlands at Wyomissing.
Hello, and welcome to the monthly program of the Historical Society of Berks County. My name is Sime Bertolet. I'm the Executive Director of the Historical Society and your host for the evening. I'd like to remind our viewers that this program is broadcast live the first Wednesday of every month at 7 p.m. It repeats the following Friday at 10 p.m., the following Saturday at 6 p.m., and the next day, Sunday, at 10 a.m. I'd like to welcome all of you to the March 2013 program of the Historical Society of Berks County. Joining me this evening are Joshua Blay, the Historical Society's Associate Director and Museum Curator. Next to Joshua is Kimberly Brown, the Director of Archives and Special Collections for the Henry Onsen Library. Seated next to Kimberly is Cindy Kauffman, coordinator for the Hendel House and friend of the Hendel. And next to Cindy is Mike Feeney, owner of the John P. Feeney Funeral Home. Thank you. Thank you all for joining us this evening.
Our museum store and Henry Onsen Library are open Tuesday through Saturday 9 to 4. Now, thankfully, this is the last time I'm going to say this. If there's ever inclement weather you want to come in, keep an eye on WFMZ.com or TV69 for any closing or delay information. Speaking of our museum store, we have a lot of good selection of toys, books, and craft items in stock. For Easter, we just got a fresh selection of Noldy Forest eggs. Come in quick, because they will go fast. And our February Easter specials are Eastertide in Pennsylvania. If it has a chance to pan down on the camera, we have the eggs, some of the eggs down there.
Can you zoom in on those? Those really are beautiful. Noldy Forest does a wonderful job on those. And they're always really well received, and a wonderful gift item. If you have friends coming in from out of town or you're going to visit them, they make a wonderful remembrance, and they are unique to Berks County. They truly are a mark of our culture in this community.
And for people closer to home, we always have gift certificates available.
Great.
Yep.
Yeah, I'd like to remind the viewers also, for those of you who are not members of the Historical Society, for as little as $55 for an individual membership, you can help the Historical Society preserve this wonderful legacy and this rich history that we have here in Berks County. And there are a lot of other benefits that go along with being a member of the Historical Society, such as you get 4 issues of our award-winning quarterly journal, The Historical Review of Berks County. You get notification on all the events and programs that we have going on at the Historical Society. You get, what else? You get admission to our museum and library unlimited throughout the year. You also are updated on what's going on at the Historical Society. And best of all, you get a voucher for 1 free ticket to our annual 4 Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. It really is a wonderful membership. And again, you're doing a great community service by being part of the Historical Society of Berks County. Founded in 1869 with a membership of over 2,000, we are one of the oldest and largest historical societies in the United States. And we're very proud of that. And I think the members of our community can be proud of that as well. And if you'd like to join as a family membership, that's $65, and you get the same benefits that I mentioned before, only you get admission for everybody in one household, all living under one roof, to the Historical Society and the library. So it really is a great organization.
And while we're on the subject of membership, Simon, we remind you watching at home that BCTV always appreciates your membership, and it's a survivor and a tough venue and a unique entity that is interactive. Give us a call with your questions and comments to 610-378-0426.
Yeah, I got to reiterate Josh's comments. Really, this is BCTV is a treasure for this community, and I think that all members of this community ought to help support BCTV and what they do. And you can do that by sending a check for $35 for a year's membership. You can mail your checks to BCTV at 645 Penn Street in Reading, Pennsylvania, at 19601. They need your support if they're to continue bringing you the programming that you've come to expect and want from BCTV. So let's see. Right now, I think we're going to turn, we're going to start the first segment of our program, and I'm going to introduce Cindy Kauffman. Cindy is the event coordinator and the coordinator for all the activities at the Hendel House, which is an annex facility for the Historical Society of Berks County. So Cindy, why don't you tell us, and I mean, it's been a while, why don't you brief the, tell the our viewing audience about maybe the history of the Hendel House, what goes on there, what's available?
Would love to.
Great.
As we go along, if there's anything I miss, Josh or Kim, please, you know, add to it. One of the other things that we should know, too, is that if you're a member of the Historical Society, you get a discount rental rate at the Hendel.
Good point.
Another good benefit of becoming a member.
Mm-hmm.
So we encourage everyone to join the Historical Society. The Hendel House is actually located at 746 Center Avenue in Historic Center Park. It was built in 1877 by a Berks County judge and attorney, James Ermentrout. I always say it wrong, and sorry, so I have to look here. The Ermentrout, though, he made the property as an, he built the property as an investment property, and his aunt lived in it for a while, and in 1890, Captain James McKnight moved in and lived there for a little while, and of course we know that he was the veteran and commander of the Ringgold Light Artillery of Reading during the Civil War. Then in 1897, Charles Hendel bought the property, and he had it enlarged to almost double the size.
Let me interject for a second. If they can put on the graphics monitor that first portrait, that was not Mr. Ermentrout.
No, that was Mr. Hendel.
That's Mr. Hendel. Put that portrait back up on the monitor. There you go.
There's Mr. Hendel.
That's who bought
the house and moved in 1898 after an extensive remodeling of the building. It was almost doubled in size at that point. And it was also done in a very elaborate and gorgeous way with lots of beautiful wood carvings and solid mahogany through the place, mm-hmm. white and cherry mahogany. He lived there, and we have a lot of notes and different things from journals of the children that while they were living there. So it lets us know what rooms were used for what and how their lifestyle was. And they must have been a very interesting couple, entertaining on weekends, and the men would play pool in the basement mm-hmm. Rec room, and the women would have a chat area from what we heard. And the house is now was lived in by the Hendels, and we should probably mention who the Hendels are. A lot of people, when they come there, always say, well, I don't know the Hendels. And I have to admit that I wasn't too familiar with them myself until I started looking into it. And Charles Hendel, who bought the Hendel, that bought the house that we now call the Hendel House, was the third generation of hat makers in the community. His father was actually Levi Hendel, and he married a woman that was part of the Bowman hat factory.
Right.
And he was a very wealthy businessman because he also owned part of the Berkshire Hotel and some other investments
Hendel
and one of the bank. Yes.
Is that right? Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
He was a very successful businessman throughout the community. So Charles Hendel lived in the house with his family, and we know that one of his sons, Paul, was actually a member of the Reading Rotary Club. And right now we have the Reading Rotary meeting at the Hendel every week. And it's kind of crazy that now we have one of the Hendels that was one of the original members.
I'm going to ask you, can you put that photograph of the Hendel back up on the monitor? Okay. Now, Cindy, when the original portion of the house
would have been the house to the right.
It's on the right.
Okay.
That was the building 1877, and then the other half of the building, which is at least the same size, if not bigger, than the original building, was built later on in 1897 when the Hendels moved in.
And it
was built by the Muhlenberg Brothers Architect Company that was in Reading at the time. And they had the first floor was their living quarters. The basement was actually more entertaining. The second floor was their bedroom suites for the family. And the third floor was servants' quarters.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I found interesting was that the kitchen, when they built it, was one of the first kitchens to have an ice box and a coal stove. in the area. And another unique feature of the house is the central vacuuming system that the Hendels had built into the house. This just shows you some of the beautiful carvings. This is the entranceway, the stairway, and in the seating there with all the wonderful carvings. Those fish that are carved there remind me of the fish that are on top of the pagoda. And we call those sashihoko, the folklore to keep the building safe from fire. And they remind me of the same shape as the ones on top of the pagoda. That's just some of the beautiful stained glass work that is in the building. It's a beautiful light color pink and this opal-like color.
So when they, like I said, you showed where that addition was put on. So actually, at first, before the addition was put on, the Hendel House faced south towards Reading.
Right. And it was one of the last buildings in the suburbs, basically. The trolley stopped a few blocks away, just about where Sterling is. The trolley ended.
Is that right?
So the Hendels would sit on the front porch and watch the trolley go by after the house was built. But there's an entrance to what we now call the Great Room that we believe was probably the front door at one time.
Okay.
And it's in the middle of the house, the way it's set up now. This is the entranceway fireplace. And that's the parlor.
What happened? Who snatched that away?
They took the parlor away. One of the nice things about what happened was the house went through, in 1950, the last Hendel, Charles's wife, Adeline, moved out, and the house was taken over by an independent Lutheran church. And it was a church for 50 years.
Mm-hmm.
Then in 2000, the church moved out, the house became available, and the granddaughter of Charles Hendel, Marjorie Hendel Perfect, bought the house and gave the deed to the Historical Society, as well as some restoration money and endowment money. The restoration went back and recreated the parlor and some of the original wallpaper. This is from the parlor looking into the music room. You can see some of the beautiful chandelier work and wood carvings and so forth. The fireplace there is all little individual pieces of tile and very, very beautiful work. Craftsmanship is amazing. All the doors are pocket doors. The windows still have the working shutters. Mm-hmm. And this we call the music room. It's got two grandfather clocks and
Vitrola
and a piano, and also a player piano that someday we'll have to see if it works. This is a great room, and I brought a couple pictures just to show some of the layout. This is how we laid it out for a workshop that we had at the Hendel. This is a theater-type production. We have a sound system. We have a screen that is hidden up under one of the valances there. This was just set up for a quiet demonstration and showed how during the holidays we had some snowflakes on the window and some of the decorations in that room. But this is laid out in some of the round tables that we can use for some of the dinners and catering events that we've had. We've had some beautiful weddings at the Hendel.
I was married at the Hendel.
That's right, you were.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's...
Speaking of weddings, one of the neater experiences I've had, I took two couples that were celebrating their anniversary that had been married on the same day in the church, and they were back, I believe it was for their 50th anniversary, and I took them all around the building, and they were telling me what the church had used each room for. Like upstairs was the Sunday school room and what have you. It was neat.
Just this past week, I unfortunately had to go to a funeral, and it was a family member of my husband's. And we get there, and it's his cousin's husband that passed away, and their daughter's husband was a minister, and he was baptized at the Hendel House.
Oh, really?
And yeah, he said, I would love to be able to come back and see it. So I said to him, he has to come back and tell us more. That's the Hendel House sign, that kind of our tag we've been using, because it is just perfect for all kinds of special events and, I think, special memories. The HendelHouse.org can be gotten to through the Historical Society's website, or you can go out on that HendelHouse.org, and we have all the information about renting it and some pictures and different things that happen at the Hendel. The Hendels were quite a family. I really was impressed with some of the information. Their hat industry must have been magnificent at that time.
Well, hat manufacturing in Reading was huge. We were one of the
first
one of the hat manufacturing centers in the in the United States.
One of the first industries, I think, of Reading. I can remember when we did the 250th anniversary of Reading. One of the things that was interesting was that we were talking about at that time the center square. You could have gone and walked in center Reading and seen the hats on the fence posts and the roofs drying. And they talked about the early industries, and hat manufacturing was right there in 1748. But the Hendels must have been quite the industry. At one point, they were down around 3rd and Pine Street, mm-hmm. and they had over 300 employees at that time. And that's a big industry.
That is.
They had the exclusivity of fur hats at one point, and they were the largest hat manufacturer in the nation, I guess, east of the Mississippi. I don't know how much was developed to the west of that, but they were one of the largest manufacturers of hats. And Charles's son, Paul, had the industry when there was a huge fire in 1926, and he rebuilt the factory, and it was in existence till 1956, mm-hmm. and then the Hendels closed their hat factory. But interesting family, beautiful building. I keep saying I fall in love with it more every time I walk into it.
So they closed their hat factory. Did Hendel, as a hat manufacturer, go out of business in that time, or was that when they went out of business, or was it later on?
The notes that I had was that the C.W. Hendel Hat Factory ceased operations in 1956.
Okay.
It just ceased operations at that point.
And the reason I was thinking about that is they really say that JFK was the one individual who killed the men's hat business.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. JFK didn't wear hats. All the men, especially politicians, they all wore hats, Homburgs or fedoras or things like that, up until JFK. And JFK didn't wear it, and all of a sudden, and he was pretty much of a trendsetter, as a young guy, 42 years old, good looking, always had a nice tan, wore really close cut suits, and they say that he really drove that issue, and killed the hat business. That's why when you say they closed in 56, that was a little prior to JFK.
Yeah, but Jackie Kennedy always wore hats. Well,
that's right. Yeah, yeah,
and that
yeah.
guy too. So.
Yep, that's it for sure.
I remember seeing an inauguration photo of Kennedy, and Eisenhower was wearing a very nice, maybe even a top hat.
Yeah,
he wasn't wearing a hat whatsoever.
Didn't wear a top coat either. So yeah.
Well, when we were doing some research for the Reading's 250th, we were looking at some photos and posters from probably one of the other Susquehcentennial celebrations or whatever, and all the heads of the committees were men, and they all had their black suits and they had their black top hats on, mm-hmm. and then they had a large picture at the bottom and said the working committee, and it was all women, and they were all dressed in their whites, and it was funny when we decided to take the picture from our 250th anniversary with the committee that worked. There were three women on the committee, and we decided that we would all make sure that we were noticed in the picture. And I said, and I made sure I wore slacks.
Great.
So that they knew that we had to come from the white cotton skirts and blouses to wearing pants.
But something interesting that Cindy pointed out is that a lot of people don't know that mansions are generally not named after the person who built them.
Right.
Good They're point. Named after the person who made them more famous,
mm-hmm.
i.e. like the Wilhelm Mansion was not built by Wilhelm, and now it's known as Adrian's.
Yeah, okay.
So mansions are generally not named after the person who built them or who may have occupied them in early. I think George Mizer pointed that out to me, that they're named after people who made them more renowned or more famous.
Well, now you have a beautiful property there in Center mm-hmm. Park. Now, and did it have, it was what? It was Nolan's estate.
Well, it was built by Nolan, and Mary Nolan married E.J. Dives, who started the Dives Palmer Stewart Stores.
Okay.
And when we first took over the property in 69, we would advertise it as a historic Dives mansion, and George came in and he said, your father's made this more famous than anyone else, so it should be the Feeney Mansion. So I thought mansion sounded too precocious or something, so I called it John P. Feeney Residence.
Right, okay.
So it sort of softened it a little bit.
Well, we had that issue when I first got to the Historical Society. You know, there was debate among the trustees, just, you know, do we call it the Hendel Mansion or do we call it the Hendel House? And we were just thinking, well, the mansion might have sounded a little bit too elite.
Uppity.
Yeah, a little too elite, so yeah. They opted to call it the Hendel House, and hence, you know, it has that name today. But any other tidbits you have for us on the Hendel?
I'm just thinking, I don't think so. I think we covered pretty much everything, except, like I said, one of the interesting things is that Reading Rotary, who's celebrating their centennial year this mm-hmm. year, has moved all their meetings to the Hendel. The first meeting of the month, they meet on a Thursday, is an evening meeting, and it's dinner and a program. And then the rest of the month, they meet in the morning at 7:30 in the morning. It's breakfast and a program. What was interesting was that when we were doing some research, because it is a centennial year, that Paul Hendel, who was Charles's son, was one of the early members of the Reading Rotary Club. And, of course, I managed the pagoda, too, and Jonathan Mould, who gave the pagoda to the city, was also an early member of the Reading Rotary.
Huh.
So we're finding some names that are familiar to the community as early members of the Reading Rotary. And it's very unique that there's 32,000 Rotary clubs in the world, and we were formed as number 88 in the whole world. In 1913, the Reading Rotary was formed. And I believe a lot had to do definitely with the train, just like the Junior League is one of the very early Junior Leagues that was formed in all the Junior Leagues in the United States mm-hmm. and internationally. So it's kind of exciting to see things happening.
That is. That's great. And tell us again, tell the audience again. I mean, the Hendel House is an incredible place to rent. If you have a special occasion that you want to celebrate, I don't think you find a more lovely venue than the Hendel. So, Cindy,
and
you know.
We recommend that you can use it. The first floor technically can hold 100 people, but that's not 100 people to sit down and eat. That's there.
A reception.
I think we have a home viewer then, too.
Okay.
But seating-wise, we probably can sit down 50 people very comfortably for a dinner. And so that's kind of an intimate kind of shower, a rehearsal dinner, a party, a birthday party, you know, family reunions and so forth.
How do they get a hold of you?
They can go to the website and all that information will come to me. And
do you want to give a telephone number?
Sure, you can also call my cell phone number. It's 610-413-8520. Or just go to hendelhouse.org, and the email there will come to me as well.
Great.
And we'd love to, you know, rent it out or even just call to come and see a personal tour and see if it fits some kind of family reunion or some other type of event.
Okay. We did have a home viewer that wanted to put a call in. Is it a question on the Hendel? Home viewer, are you there?
Yes.
Hello?
Hello.
Hi, how you doing?
I'm all right. I'm just listening to you talk about the Hendel House, and not once did you mention where it is.
Oh, we did.
Thank you very much.
We did mention in the very beginning. It's at 746 Center Avenue. It's the corner of Center Avenue and Douglas Street, right in Historic Center Park.
Does that answer that question for you, home viewer? Hello?
He's gone.
I guess so.
But it is in Historic Center Park at 746. It's one of the 840 properties of the Historic Center Park.
Yeah. And it generally is, it's always on the, it's open during the Spring Garden Tour.
If there's something going on in Center Park, we open our doors as well to hopefully have people come in and see the facility and also be part of that community. We are part of the holiday Christmas house tour, and whatever's their flea markets and so forth, we've been, you know, able to be part of the historic Center Park.
Well, that's great. Well, Cindy, thank you so very much for being part of that. That is great, great. Yeah, the Hendel House is a wonderful facility. We encourage all of you to, if you haven't seen it, come by and take a look. I think that next time you need a venue for one of your events, you'll think of the Hendel House. Josh, what else we got now before we go to the break?
Well, let's see here. We'll play a few minutes. This past Saturday, on March 2nd, we went back about 3,400 years in time without a DeLorean. Kitty Jones from Kitts Interactive Theater joined us to present Wonders of Ancient Egypt, 1473 B.C. She interpreted Queen Hatshepsut. And we have a little video of
her.
Easy
for you to say.
I'm amazed I got that right. She showed me the simple way to pronounce it. That's how I got it right twice in a row. So here's a simple little video taken with Sime's flip.
Not at 18, but I do have two really strong farmers. Can I bring them up here? Very good. You see if I can find them. I found them. Sweetheart, will you join me here? In Mokta, I will move your hand step closer towards me, simply because I can't with skin right there. My darling, will you join me? Looking very pretty for his brother. Now, these two farmers, oh, darling, I'm going to ask you to raise your hands in the air. We have to leave property entirely if you're going to be building the pyramids. Now, these two farmers were just one of many, two, I should say, since I'm counting both of them, who built the pyramids. Now, Tazer, I feel as though some people will think it was the slaves who built the pyramids. You and I know that is not true, correct? Right. Well, maybe, because it is. Raise your hands, darling. You see, my friends, the farmers, when the fields are being flooded, cannot plow their fields. So they have a good deal of time on their hands to help build the pyramids. Two of you, I want you to stand side by side with your face in the sun. It is very hard to plow the fields when they are flooded. Remember, was it 2 or 3 years ago you tried it? How many? Well, who keeps track? You try to plow, it doesn't work, and then you try to forget about it. But the point is, they cannot plow the fields, so they will build the pyramid. Now, Imhotep wanted nothing more than to please the king, to make him smile. Will you stand here, Tazer, with your face in the sun? So what Imhotep would do is clap his hands twice like this. Good! And he would point to the largest stone he could find. Imhotep, I think it's over there. Good. So, the two brothers, one would stand on one side of the block here, the other would stand on the other side of the block over there, and very slowly, because this is so heavy, they would raise the
Kids
block
so theater.
As high as their knees.
Really is a special event. I think, I'm not exactly sure, I think this is either eighth or ninth time, annual event that Kitty Jones has visited the Historical Society. She does a great interactive presentation. And she really incorporates the audience in everything she does. And we're fortunate to be able to bring this program to Berks County. We thank the Gerald Lynn Foundation. They provide a great deal of the underwriting support as well as the HSBC Auxiliary. So we really thank them. This year we went a little bit outside of the box and really didn't have too much of a tie to Berks County history. But it's just a great program. Last year Kitty did the Renaissance, and that was equally well received. So yeah, it's a nice, that's a real good program. We thank Gerald Lynn and the Auxiliary for helping us do that and allowing us to do that. We appreciate all of you who attended this one, and know that Kitty will be back next March with another program. So we encourage all of you to join us when that comes. And I guess we have to take a break now. Okay, great.
You're watching the Historical Society of Berks County on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local heritage societies and local history, go to bctv.org. The Historical Society of Berks County on bctv.org is underwritten by the Highlands. To find out how you and your business can support a program on BCTV, go to bctv.org.
Well, it's good to be back. Now we're going to introduce our next guest. And again, Mike Feeney's a good old friend of the Historical Society. He's in the Center Park Historic District, as the Historical Society is. And he is the owner of the John P. Feeney Funeral Home.
Okay, you got it that time.
I did get it that time. Thank you. And now I'm going to turn this over right now to Kim and let her do a secondary introduction to Mike, because she has a program with Mike that they're going to talk a little bit about on tonight's program that's coming up at the Henry Johnson Library.
It's for the Henry Johnson Library,
right,
but
exactly.
It's not in the Henry Johnson Library.
No, okay, go ahead.
Well, you know, we're in the last and final month of our second annual archival lecture series, and which is why Mr. Feeney is on tonight, because he is going to be our March 23rd program at 1 o'clock, and it will be in the Connor Auditorium in the main building at 940, because there's not enough space in the library and we have to serve the researchers. So hopefully, we're hoping that Mr. Feeney talks about funerary practices, the history of the Feeney Funeral Home, and how to access funeral records. And we're very excited that he's going to be joining us on March 23rd. So I'm going to turn it over to you.
Well, thank you. And it's anytime I can talk about things that enhance public knowledge, I just love it. I wish our funeral records through the state would be more accessible, and we're working on that. But Sime, you know, you've done great at the Historical Society. I love being a part of the Historical District. And what people don't understand, if they come to Center Park, they're going to see probably the most beautiful architecture in Berks County. This was the gem, the architectural gem center of Berks County. Every mansion is different, outside and inside, because they didn't want their mansion to look like any other mansion. So at our mansion, most of the brick you see in our building was made right on site.
Right on site,
because if you stand in front on a sunny day and look up the side of the front of the building, you'll see that some of the brick is twisted or thinner or thicker, because it wasn't fully cured when they put it on. So you know, it's radiators inside don't look like radiators anywhere else. You talk about the entire shutters. I always wondered with the Christmas story. Mm-hmm. I jumped out of bed, I threw open the shutters and threw up the sash. I said, wait a minute, the shutters are on the outside of the building. Not in Old England. They're on the inside like they are in your building and my building. So that's how they open the shutters first, then you throw open the sash. Okay, so anyway. My father started the funeral home back in 1941, before the war, and was already successful. And when the war broke out, he was the only funeral director to voluntarily close his funeral, even though he could have had an exception like some others did. And he joined the medical corps.
Hmm. Wow.
And my mother, a nurse, started working at an Army hospital. She wasn't in the military, but she was a nurse at an Army hospital. And when they came back in 1946, after the war, at that time, Cramp Funeral Home moved right next to the Historical Society.
Okay.
And their property on Washington Street was up for sale. Now, follow this. They had no restrictions on it. So my father bought their funeral home and opened up. And back then, a lot of people didn't have cars. They had neighborhood funeral homes that they walked to. So as a result, for the first several years, most of my father's business were cramped families.
Okay.
That could not follow them to Center Avenue because they had no way to get there for viewings.
Oh, interesting.
So, but again, then in 1969, we moved to Center Park also.
Okay.
And we took over a mansion that was built by James Nolan. He had two children, J. Bennett Nolan, who was a very well-known poet, author, and all that. And his daughter, Mary Nolan, that was James Nolan, the senior, she married E.J. Dives, who started the Dives Primary Stewart Stores.
Okay.
And their summer home was the Precious Blood Convent in Shillington. Back then, that was a half-day ride by carriage. So you start tying.
So there's Precious Blood there on what road?
Welsh Road.
That's on Welsh Road.
Right. That was the summer
centuries.
Home for the Dives.
Huh.
J. Bennett Nolan, let me just show a little bit of advertising in here.
That's all right.
But J. Bennett Nolan's property at the corner of Madison and Oley is up for sale right now.
Oh, wow.
And it's a very beautiful, unbelievable stained glass throughout. So if anybody wants to drive by and take a look at it, but it's a gem. If I needed another property in Reading, I would probably acquire.
Well, he used to be president of the Historical Society.
Who's that?
Jay Bennett.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Very. And he died there, and his viewing was held right in his own home.
Huh.
Huh. Okay? Jack and Steve told me that. I wasn't around when that happened. I think Jack and Steve were probably there when Moses came over. No. Jack and Steve are good friends. But anyway, my father moved to Center Avenue, and shortly thereafter, you know, is when the historic district formed itself, and it was a very, very important thing because it kept all of our buildings from being painted green, yellow, orange, purple, whatever, mm-hmm. which unfortunately, as we all know, destroys the value of the neighborhood. So if you have a chance to get into a historic district, please do so. You know, it definitely helps your property values. But having the Historical Society at one end, you know, and I say overlooking the Feeney Mansion at the other end, yeah. you know, we still have Center Avenue covered.
Yeah.
But did you notice that Center Avenue is never, ever crowded with cars? You know?
It really isn't.
Isn't it? It's a wide open, tree-lined, and when we have our summer events and our winter events, and the art, again, the architecture is just unbelievable. But we're here to talk about more about funerary and you know, trying to get information. Records in most state offices, most state vital statistics offices are restricted access records that, you know, if you have a purpose for them, you can get them. But trying to get something for genealogy is almost like pulling teeth. Mm-hmm. There's work in the state to try to get them to have a website where you could type in a name mm-hmm. and see everything without critical information. No social security numbers, no employment history, maybe that he served in the military, but not as with his. And others, you know, information that's not going to hurt. But I think the biggest thing that's happening now that's hurting genealogy is that a lot of people are not having obituaries in the newspaper.
Is that right?
Obituaries are not required by law. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay? And we sort of explain to our families when they say, I don't want an obituary. I said, there was a docket when she was born. Mm-hmm. Now, if you don't have a docket to close that, this person goes poof. I mean, there's no record of his children. There's no way for anyone 50 years from now to trace back and find that person in history. You know, they just disappear after birth. And
they're also not required to put it in the Eagle.
No, they're not required
to
put it anywhere.
So I think we're missing obituaries
yeah.
and vital statistics because
oh, yeah.
they're not
yeah, last year, I'd say we probably had about mm-hmm. 15 that did not have, at our funeral, that did not have obituaries.
Can you back up for just a second? Now, you're talking about the deeds. I mean, the records, death records, are not accessible. Is that unique to Pennsylvania?
No.
Okay.
No. I tried to get a death certificate last year. The person that died made us beneficiary to take care of the funeral, mm-hmm. but she never took her brother off the policy, and he died in 1957. Mm-hmm. And this was in Arizona. And I had to go down to get a short form from the county to get it. And then they still didn't want to release it to me. So someone in the office finally realized, oh, this is over 50 years. We can release it. So we spent about $200 of estate money doing things that we didn't have to do because that agency did not realize what their records were. But no, it's very difficult to get records out of the state.
Unless they're 50 years old. Then they can
right.
release them.
Usually there's like a 50-year time span.
Okay.
But what we try to explain to our families, and if any of the funeral directors are watching this, I hope they do also, mm-hmm. that the newspaper offers a free, what I'm now calling a genealogy obituary. Name, date of birth, parents' names, and a couple family names. Maybe where they worked at, but 16 lines at no charge.
Okay.
No charge. But that helps genealogy down the road make this trace back. But we get calls weekly, you know, people trying to trace back families. And we'll have, you know, our records go back to 1941, so if we have it, we'll pull it out and we'll give them what we can, not anything sensitive.
Sure.
But it's just that people don't realize how people in the state don't realize how difficult it is. And, you know, if it was in the newspaper, why can't the state give out the same thing on a website? Make it easier for everybody. But genealogy is really difficult in Pennsylvania and most other states.
And most
it's
other
not
states.
A priority either.
No, it's not. No, never will be.
Right.
The new death certificate came out for the state of Pennsylvania, and the funeral directors start complaining. They went from a 11-inch form to a 14-inch form, which is difficult to print, reproduce, copy, and everything. Mm-hmm. And they have two questions on there, and we can't be. Item 20 is race. Check as many as apply. They have like 13 different categories of race. There's not a Hispanic race. They're Caucasian,
okay.
with Hispanic as a subcategory. As we are Caucasian, Irish is a subcategory. But you have Filipino, Chamorro, Gomorrah, Japanese, Vietnamese. So there's Chinese. So there's a whole plethora of races. So that's question number 20. okay? And that's what the family will tell us what they were. Question 21, and none of us can understand how we can actually legally answer that question inside the neighborhoods, because now you understand this person has died. And that question says, what does he or she consider himself or herself to be?
Okay.
I can't ask him.
the conversation will be very one-sided.
And then they said, well, what does the family consider? I said, well, that's what we answered in 20.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. So again, you know, the state, many, you know, it's comical. or they're actually turning funeral directors now into
statisticians.
There you go. Okay, I know. You said that other one. I knew it could
count. That's why.
But anyway. But they ask questions like, you know, the person's 92 and died. Well, what grade did they complete in school? Most of them didn't go to school. And the children have no idea. Grandchildren have no idea because grandma probably never discussed it with them. Because she was probably sort of embarrassed that she only went to sixth grade. But then later, I always say, we'll give them 12 years school of hard knocks. They went through the Depression. Okay, you can get a GED, so you can also get a GED for living. But no, they ask some questions that are really dumb, but then don't ask questions which are pertinent. My brother did a whole thing going back into Ireland with my family. I think we found one horse thief in the family, but he's sort of pushing them aside.
Those are the best ones.
Yeah.
The black sheep of the family.
They come out. But again, it is very difficult to get records to understand where you're coming from. And I think everybody should have an inborn desire to find out when their family came to the United States. Whether they come in steerage or were they up top? You know, what boat did they come over on? You know, where did they first live at? But it's difficult to trade. Now, I know they have this ancestry.com. I've never gone on it. I don't know how it works, but I'm sure that somehow they got state records that are probably 50 years old. But the current ones are not going to have because they couldn't get them released unless they get it from the newspapers. And if you don't put that obituary, if you're watching right now and you're saying, I don't want my obituary in the newspaper, please put the genealogy obituary in. It doesn't cost you anything. And really, 10, 15, 20 years down the road, if your grandchildren want to do research, you're there. They know everything about you.
And answer question 21. Write it down somewhere.
In advance, right.
And we'd like to point out that Ancestry.com isn't always necessarily accurate.
Right.
So you always have to go back to the original source to verify the information.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I think Ancestry.com is great for us because people start using it, and if they get that interest, soon enough they're going to find that they've got to come to places like the Historical Society of Berks County.
What kind of records do you have at the Historical Society for?
We have church records from, you know, not quite all, but I would say half of all the churches in Berks County, tombstone inscriptions from a number of cemeteries. Mm-hmm. We do have, I think, 5 or 6 funeral home records.
Did left to get out of business?
Yeah, we ended up getting the information. Then we've got like over 4,000 recorded deeds, unrecorded deeds. We've got the original tax list of Berks County. We've got the census records, except from the 1940 census, that's available online. You name it.
Well, how far did your cemetery records? What did you say, 1742 or something?
Well, the earliest churches established were 1732, so it would be correspondingly the same for the cemetery records.
Right.
Yeah, because most of those cemeteries, those stones were sandstone, and now they're basically...
Yeah, you can't.
There's a way, I think, an infrared way that you can get and read a lot of the inscriptions, but if anyone ever goes out to Charles Evans, which, you know, is on the border of the historic district also, and walk through that cemetery, you would not believe what you can learn about the history of Berks County. If you come in there, main gate on Center Avenue, and turn right and walk down along the fence, there is a large slab, probably 7 foot by 3 foot, with a skull and crossbones, and in German, do not violate this grave. Okay? You will be shot. But no, they have pyramids out there,
obelisks,
tower, you know, pedestals that are 20 feet high with a 10-foot angel on top of them. You know, it's just unbelievable. Nelson Farr,
right,
who was the sexton there for many years, said he has 3,000 trees on the property. And when I ran for coroner, he said he's going to have everyone under him vote for me. But, you know, cemeteries are good for records also. When you get out to some of the small church cemeteries, they have unpaid staff. and the sextons do as good as they can, but it's difficult for them to pull records together, even read the old records.
So, well, and sometimes the tombstones are contain just as much information.
Yep.
But you also be very wary when reading tombstones, as we're learning from Fred Paul, who is one of our favorite Saturday researchers. There are certain times during a day that you're going to be able to read the old tombstones the best. So if you read it, like, he's working up at Salem Bellum, so I think he said it's about 12:30 to 1:30 that he can get the best viewings on the tombstones.
The light hits
anything
it.
After sunshine. That, and the tombstones say something totally different.
Wow.
So you have to watch with those old tombstones.
It's all those things you used to turn, and it changes pictures when you
yeah.
turn.
Yeah. Yeah. You see, you have to be careful when you're viewing the tombstones, because sometimes you really do need direct light to read, especially the German ones. To get the right perspective.
And you know, a lot of the old graves, those stones are no longer over the grave.
They've been moved
mm-hmm. because the ground will freeze and move, you know. And the
well, sure.
Yeah, so a lot of times that grave may be 5 or 10 feet away from where the actual stone is. Mm-hmm.
Well, how is, now, you know, there's been, I would imagine there's been a rise in, cremation
oh,
over.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So there you don't have a tombstone. There you don't have, you might not have the death record, you might not have the obituary. I mean, they're gone
right.
forever, yeah.
They're gone. If you don't have that newspaper thing, and, you know, I contacted the editor of the newspaper and said, you know, you guys should run an article on this trying to explain the necessity for having mm-hmm. the genealogy obituary at least. He said, well, that would be self-serving of us, and he didn't do it. And I think, you know.
But it's for free.
Yeah, I know, but they say, you know, we can try to get it out from them, but they had the bully pulpit. That they could put it in, and because it's free, they're not benefiting from it. But again, maybe one of you guys can call down and talk to them. And
we could put an article in the review.
Yeah.
Yeah, that could work.
But anyway, Simon, I want to offer you something. We do this with other organizations. Little sales pitch here.
Okay.
It doesn't benefit me, it benefits you.
We always like that.
We deal with some others, and you know, we try to help out the local charities and local groups and organizations, mm-hmm. not national. And if anyone does consider pre-planning with us on a traditional funeral, if they write a check for $500, up to $500 to the Historical Society, we will deduct that from our funeral bill.
Wow.
So it's either pay us or pay you.
Well, we thank you very
but,
much.
And on a cremation service, of course, it's half of that, $250. But again, if they just come in on a pre-plan or at need and say, I'd like to write a check to the Historical Society for $500, we'll just deduct that as a charitable donation right from the funeral bill. And again, they're not going to pay any more, but the Historical Society will benefit from it.
Well, thank you, Mike.
And I encourage all my other funeral directors to do the same thing, because it might not just be the Historical Society, it could be the RSO. My only policy is that it has to benefit local.
Yeah.
It can't go to some organization, you know, three states away. If it has a local tie and all the funds there are spent locally, you know, we can make the deduction.
Well, that's a great community service.
Another thing that we've had at the Hendel House is after some of the funeral services, we've had people come back to the Hendel for the funeral
mm-hmm.
after the funeral lunches.
Sure. Yep.
Because it's more home-like than going somewhere to a restaurant or something. And it's an area that we didn't even think of or tap into.
Yep.
And we really strongly suggest that any funeral homes around, if their folks say they're looking for something for the family afterwards, to check the Hendel House out.
We do light snacks at the funeral mass after some service, like cremation where there's no burial, or burial where the burial is going to be at a later time. But we only started doing that because the state law was challenged and
mm-hmm.
Was thrown out by the federal court probably about 4 or 5 months ago. There was a restriction on the funeral home serving food or drink at the funeral home. And the federal judge said something like, you know, funeral homes are cleaner than hospitals and nursing homes.
<That's> true.
Unless they stop them from serving food also. But no, the funeral law is changing. It was very antiquated. We do light snacks. But again, a lot of times people are looking for the place. I'm glad to know that, because they can leave the cars parked there and just walk up the street and see beautiful Center Park.
And one of the nice things about the Hendel House is that our policy is that you don't, you can bring in your own caterer. We'll have a preferred list of caterers, but you can bring in your own food, or even the family could bring their potluck or something.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not as though you're paying for the food at the Hendel, you're paying for the venue, and then you can make it mm-hmm. enjoyable for whatever you want it to be.
Sure.
And one of the other things we do, and I'm sure I don't know if you've been down to any of them, but we do opera workshops Berks Abbot Workshop has their office at our location and has their meetings there. American Legion Great Post number 12, who's one of the largest American Legions in the country. They used to own the school, which is the 10th and Penn right now. The entire building was owned by them. They had a bowling alley in the basement. They had a stage that came out and actually revolved in their big dining room. But like all other clubs like that, they're, you know, dwindling membership, so now they hold their meetings once a month at our location. And then four times a year, we actually do opera. Our next one coming up, Berks Opera Workshop is doing a fundraiser at our mansion. It's Sunday, April 14th. I'm not sure what the ticket price is. I think it might be like $60 or something, but it's going to be the opera. We'll do some hors d'oeuvres and wine tasting prior to it, then the opera, and then the singing, and then afterwards, then we're going to have a buffet-type dinner. But again, I would love if we could get every mansion in Center Park to do something at least once a year.
Yeah.
And I was also looking at trying to talk the Center Park Historic District into doing a wine tour. You know that you know, we can't have any wine in Center Park itself as the park, because that's city owned and there's a regulation against it.
Sure.
But I said, like, Adrian could have a tent on her property, Hendel House, the historic.
Come have a drink
society
at the Hendel.
But, you know, they buy a wristband and they come around and they sip the wine. And what the wineries want to do is they have the wine to sell, because they can sell it then. So they make their money on selling their bottles of wine to people who like it. But again, you know, we have to look in the historical district, we have to look at better ways to entice the people to want to come and take a look at us.
Like you said, and it's such a beautiful area. The, you know, the Center Park Historic District, you know, really portrays and showcases a period of the industrial strength of this community.
And
you know, when we, you know, when industry in Reading and Berks County was, it was a manufacturing hub.
Yeah.
And it really has a great legacy. Yeah. That needs to, that story needs to be told. Mike, thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
I appreciate that. I appreciate you being here and sharing that with
and
us.
Looking forward to seeing you on the
23rd.
By the way, if you want, we have the ability now to web broadcast. So on the 23rd, if you want, we could web broadcast that entire thing. So people who could not come, let's say they're handicapped or incapacitated, they could actually log into our funeral website, click on special events, and they'd be able to watch that live.
That would be, that would be cool.
Like that. We could do that, you know, as a way of getting it.
It'd be a first for us.
Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That is neat.
So. Excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Well, before I turn it over to Josh to go things to talk about the last event of the evening, I'd also like to remind the viewers that the Rainbow Theater will be, Carol Toomey's Rainbow Theater will be coming to the Historical Society. The production this year is Molly, an American Girl's Story. That's really popular, so popular that they've sold out one of the four performances. But we still have tickets available for the Saturday, April 6th, 3 p.m. and 7 p.m. show, as well as the Sunday, April 7th show at 4 p.m. That's going to be held at the Historical Society's headquarters at 940 Center Avenue. Children are $10, adults are $12, but that includes refreshments, a meet and greet with the cast members, and it's suitable for ages 5 years and older, must be accompanied by an adult. Josh, what do you have? We have something great going on this weekend.
We do, but before we get to that, we probably should mention Second Saturday real quick.
Oh, sure, go ahead.
We might run out of time. On this coming Saturday, second Saturday, March 9th.
March 9th,
at 10 a.m., we're having Lisa Minardi, who's an assistant curator at the Winterthur Museum. She's found a connection between Frocktour and furniture, and this is going to be a really nice program. She's done a lot of research on the decorative arts of the Pennsylvania Germanic culture. She presented a program last year that was very well attended, so we encourage you, if you're interested, please come and come soon. Come early to get a seat. The refreshments are at 9:30, and the program is at 10 o'clock itself. We'll have a quick preview. We'll do what we can here on the slideshow here. We are just about to debut a new exhibit in our lower-level transportation gallery. It's our renovated car display of our Boss car and also of our Duryea car. Those of you who are regular watchers to the show might remember that we covered this a little bit. The car was returned to us from the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. Berks County used to be a hotbed for car production back in the early 1900s. It sort of petered up by about the 19-teens, 1920s, but Daniels, SGV, Acme, Duryea, Boss were very well-known names at the time. A lot of them were used by celebrities of the day, right before Ford really started his fast production. We've had two cars in the collection. for a long time. They were donated about a year apart in 1923, 1924. The one at the top left is the Duryea car. Duryea is, of course, very well known with Duryea Drive. His shop was just a few blocks from her location. And the bottom right was the steam car boss car. Kate Turner, president of the statewide chapter of American Children of the American Revolution, got together a fundraising project for us to provide renovations to the basement, so we were able to return the car from the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. Thanks very much to Morris Kreitz and Sons for their moving. And yes, this is how we actually get stuff in the building. That's one of the most popular questions, how do you get materials in the basement? The hardest point, as you can see here, is it's on a dolly, is navigating the corner by the horse car. But Morris Kreitz very kindly donated their transportation services, and Kate, through the local chapter of the CIR and also the SAR and the DR, made matching grants to us, and this is her with her father when the car returned. We contracted with a design company to have these wonderful views of Penn Street. Believe it or not, these were 8x10s. The one on the bottom looks up towards Mount Penn, and the one on the other side looked towards Linebox Hill and West Reading. That's the graphic preview of it, and a bit more of the labels here. And that's the display today.
Well, we thank Kate and the Turners and the CAR, the Pennsylvania State Chapter, for helping us do this. I'd like to thank all of you for joining us tonight. I encourage you to tell your friends about this show, broadcast live the first Wednesday of every month at 7 p.m. And I'd also like to note the passing of one of rock and roll's great guitar players, Alvin Lee. After so many years of singing I'm Going Home, Alvin Lee finally did. God bless you, Alvin, and thank you for joining us. Good night.
The Historical Society on BCTV is supported by the Highlands at Wyomissing.